I think the best way for me to start tonight is with a brief reading from my book, because that's the best way to set the scene. I want to tell you a story about my daughter, my beautiful failure. By all the standard markers, by all the accepted rules and regulations and assessments of secondary school, my daughter graduated from school a failure. During the 2 years of her higher school certificate, she truanted frequently, she failed to hand in assignments, she failed to turn up on time, she failed to meet uniform requirements, she failed to attend some of her exams, she exhausted the patience of teachers and pushed to the outer limits the structural sympathies of the government school system. There were programs of improvement, second chances, third chances, and more. Suspension and expulsion were always just around the corner. It was difficult for her teachers, it was difficult for her parents. It was difficult for no one more than her. Every day of my daughter's high school life was a struggle. She woke up in the morning, and the prospect of going to school, sometimes even the thought of going outside, was like an enormous mountain to climb. And very often, she wasn't able to scale it. There were times when she didn't make it all the way. She would sit in the park on her own, wondering why she found it all so hard while her friends trundled on in their normality. At other times, she was doubled up in a laneway crying near the school, riveted by her anxiety. When she did make it, sitting in the class for the duration of a lesson was the next mountain in the range. Anxious thoughts crowded out her bandwidth, blocking the admission of any useful information the teacher was trying to impart. She got nervous, she got fidgety, her breath would become shallow, she wanted to take flight. She couldn't deal with the pressure and the judgment. She told me once in a moment of rare vulnerability that in one class she felt so distressed at being so behind in her classwork that she spent the whole period fighting the urge to flee and to throw herself onto the train tracks. She did flee class many, many times, mercifully never to throw herself anywhere. Nothing will ever be as easy as your school years, well-meaning adults told her, but I knew for my daughter and for many others who were square pegs trying to make themselves round, that this was dead wrong. So this was about 2 years ago that our family was at the end of a very trying few years to get our daughter through school. And while the stress of getting her there and keeping her there threatened her mental health and ours on a daily basis, she was determined to finish whatever her outcomes. Dropping out, she said, would make her feel even more like a loser. So we got her there. And long before the HSC exams began, we had all let go of any hope of any sort of useful outcome, that is a pass mark or a university entrance score. And she just had to turn up, and she mostly managed. And so strangely, the few weeks of the HSC were actually the most relaxing few weeks of her whole school experience. We didn't care about her results, she didn't care about her results. The end was in sight. And on the final day of her exam, the last day she would ever have to feel like a failure at school, she walked out euphoric and she sent me a text. "It's over," with many, many exclamation marks. And I felt this overwhelming urge to write a story that came from my heart, a true cri de coeur. And as a journalist of 30 years' experience, the act of writing articles has become like second nature, but this was something else. This was deeply personal. And there's nothing new about very personal journalism these days in the confessional style of journalism that we have now, but as an old school journalist, it was difficult to get over the idea of writing about myself and a personal experience. And I was trained in the idea of never using the word I, but I felt I had the strength of a story that had much greater meaning for all of us, not just my daughter, not just my family. It wasn't gratuitous confession for confession's sake, but an elucidation of a feeling that there was something much bigger going wrong for kids in schools, and that there was something much bigger going wrong on a societal level. As a mother to a child who, for whatever reason, would not tick the right boxes, I started asking questions about what was going wrong for my daughter. I wanted to get hold of these wriggly concepts of success and failure. As a journalist, I ended up asking larger questions about what was going on in education and what was going wrong in education, how it informs the society we live in, about the madness of this pressure, where it comes from and what it's for. And when I did so, I went from a world where only my child mattered into a world where every child matters. And what I learnt changed me as a parent, and it changed me as a thinker. The system judged my daughter to be a failure, but in reality, she had achieved something monumental. She did something that was really difficult for her every day for years, and so to us was a great success. It was actually an extraordinary feat of courage. So I became fixated by this idea that we have to rethink the way we define success in school. Is it success if you're getting straight A's and you're crying yourself to sleep at night? Is it success if you've attained the perfect ATAR but don't want to do anything with it because, frankly, the stress of school has put you off the idea of further education for the foreseeable future? Are you in receipt of a good education if you've simply followed the scaffold, ticked the right boxes, gamed the system, regurgitated the knowledge? In writing my book, I was driven by two things. I wanted to systematically track down the source of pressure on kids, because as a parent, I've lost count of the number of conversations I've had with other parents who throw up their hands and say, where does it come from? Does it come from the school? Does it come from the teachers? Does it come from within themselves? Definitely doesn't come from us. These conversations are happening at the same time that kids are experiencing higher than ever before rates of mental distress. There is something deeply disturbing going on with our kids, and it seems you can't turn around without hearing another story of a child suffering anxiety or depression. And as teens now specifically report that school stress is one of their greatest sources of anxiety, we can no longer refrain from connecting the two. And children will find their pressure valves. They will control their calorie intake in extremis until they are skin and bones. They will vomit from anxiety. They will pluck out their eyelashes one by one. They will self-medicate and risk-take or carve neat lines into their flesh until bright red droplets announce the blessed sigh of release. So many are suffering in this quest for success as we have defined it for them. But not only those who fail suffer, the children who succeed are suffering too. Secondly, I really wanted to challenge all the platitudes and accepted wisdoms that came our way when my daughter was struggling with school. There is so much about school and education that is perpetuated by virtue of the fact that we so rarely question all our time-honoured beliefs about the best way to educate kids. And all this led to a third thing, which was an overarching desire to philosophically unpick the ideas of what school is for and what education should be. This worked not only on a personal level, but on a political and societal level, for there is no other area of public policy that so affects the society that we have and could be altered to attain the society that we want. So let's start with some of the things that people said to me repeatedly when my daughter was struggling. School is not for everyone. She's got to get used to the pressure and the competition because real life is like that. The school years are the easiest years of your life. Obviously, she's just decided that she doesn't want to do well or learn, so it's up to her. So let's take school is not for everyone. At first, when people told me this, I thought, yeah, okay, I guess that's right. We've all come to accept this, that we've all heard so many stories of school dropouts who have risen from the ashes of an unedifying school experience to go on to lead great successful lives in spite of their education, not because of it. School is not for everyone. But the more I thought about it, the more I really thought that this is just saying yes, okay, and it's some kind of pathetic surrender to a questionable idea. Shouldn't school be for everyone? Shouldn't school be a place for every child to be educated and for every child to be given the opportunity to reach their potential? We have settled on such a narrow view of success in school that so many kids fall outside that view and feel wrong and feel like failures. And they don't get the chance to find out what their strengths are because they're too occupied with their faults and try to make themselves round to fit the round hole. Now, there's another thing that people said to me, and this is probably the most repeated comment, which was, she's got to get used to the pressure and competition because life is like that. And this was one of the most interesting parts of my research, and I found it absolutely fascinating to really prod the idea that competition is necessary to performance, educational performance. And the whole psychology and philosophy behind the way we think about this is really interesting. And during the time my daughter was struggling with school, I would talk to her about what made her most anxious, and she had a one-word answer. It's competition. And most parents I spoke to just naturally believe that competition was part of education, and yet most academics I spoke to said the opposite, and this gap in thinking really interested me. If we put aside the notion that school should be a training ground for adult life, and that deserves a different type of scrutiny, we can look at how competition works in education. And I did look at both sides of the argument, the one that says competition drives performance, and the other that says that competition is damaging not only to kids, but damaging to the process of education itself. And as I said, most academics fell in line with that idea that competition corrupts education, and kids subconsciously receive the message that they have to beat other children to get ahead. The ranking of individuals, grading kids, putting them into ability groups has enjoyed a largely unquestioned role in education. And it was fascinating to talk to educators who are looking for other ways to establish the ability of kids without reaching for the easy handles of letters and numbers that obviously cannot adequately describe a child. It was also, to me, another indication of the desperate need that we have to talk to parents about the way we talk about education. Another platitude, the school years are the easiest years of your life. Well, this is patently untrue for a lot of kids, and of course we cannot know until life's end which are actually the easiest years. But a lot of people our age that say that this is because school actually wasn't a major stress for us and things haven't changed, have they? They think they're still the same. But I fear there is a lot of damage being done to kids during a very vulnerable time, at a time they should be discovering their strengths and establishing a strong sense of themselves. They're experiencing adult-like pressures because of this misguided notion that they better get used to it. And it's preparing them for adult life. We really need to talk about keeping our kids in the bubble of childhood for a little bit longer. I spoke to young people who felt that they were losing the best years of their lives because they were spending their whole time studying. They actually said they didn't know how to think for themselves, which is actually terrifying. I spoke to kids who felt like they didn't matter, who felt like they didn't have a say in anything, who felt angry, ignored, and completely negated by a system that demands uniformity and conformity. A lot of them said they felt like they were constantly in the frame of a problem, and that is that the discussion is always around where they're going wrong. This idea of feeling like they matter is crucial to kids, and this is where teacher-student relationships can be absolutely vital. I know it was for my daughter, who had a mentor who made her feel like he was in her corner. In a system that can make kids feel less than, a teacher that makes them feel okay can literally keep them alive. We're talking at heart about compassion, but teachers are under pressure too, and sometimes it can take time to dig deep to find that compassion. Good teaching, like good parenting, is being responsive to the hand you've been dealt. And trust me, I've learnt this the hard way. But the system makes it difficult for teachers to be supportive where it should be designed to help them support them and our kids. Now, the mystery of this pressure, this goddamn pressure, I really believe that in the space of a generation, pressure on kids has been ramped up. There's been a shift, the stakes have been raised, and a lot of parents really don't understand it or how it happened. I look back on my own school years, and I'm sure a lot of you do too, and don't recall this kind of pressure. In fact, I recall a certain kind of benign neglect from my parents around exam pressure And this doesn't mean there wasn't encouragement or help if I needed it, but there wasn't any measure of overinvestment in the outcome. I was supposed to be getting a good education and learning how to think. That was the desired outcome. They also believed, shock horror, that adolescence was a time for kids to have fun and to find out who they are and get a sense of themselves. This is, after all, the most important task of adolescence. These days, parents can be so overinvested in their children's academic careers, and it starts early. One woman I interviewed who looked after admissions in a primary school told me how she was shocked by the number of parents who would come in with their four-year-olds holding onto their legs in their tutus and their Spider-Man outfits, asking how they could better their children's chances to get ahead, how they could get them into the gifted and talented program, and if there was anything they could do. She'd look at these little things and think, it starts now. The academic race gun has just gone off. At the other end of the journey, overinvestment can reach fever pitch during final exam times as parents become fixated on the all-important ATAR. Just last week, there was a story that one mental health organisation was putting on extra counselling services for parents who needed help coping with their kids' exams. And we've come to accept this as something we need to have, without actually thinking about how to reduce the pressure. Systemically, the idea of getting ahead is perpetuated by NAPLAN, which has become part of the furniture despite the fact it makes small children sick with worry and puts pressure on teachers and is delivered with a great deal of inconsistency between schools. Then we have competition between schools, both private and public, and then this overarching pressure of global competitiveness, which has become part of the landscape thanks to the triennial PISA testing, which is now a proxy for the way we measure the efficacy of our education system. The results arrive with fanfare every 3 years, get a lot of publicity, and then there is this general wailing and gnashing of teeth about how Poland now has a better education system than us. And politicians say it's not good enough, and they wheel the results like a blunt instrument to bash us all into shape about how we've got to do better, we must do better. And the downward pressure makes its way down through all the layers to the end user, which is the child in the classroom. And all this underscores the messages we all receive about getting ahead, about getting our kids ahead in front of the pack and try to win this race that education has become. I don't actually blame parents for these sorts of desires for their children, although it does desperately require some self-examination. We're all susceptible to societal messages, and these ones have been strong. We've all been told over and over again that academic attainment is the way to get ahead in life, and who would want to be seen to holding their children back? So yes, in subtle and not so subtle ways, pressure does come from parents. It comes from the way we talk about education only in terms of outcomes. We all grab on to the easy handles of grades and rankings because this is the way we've learned to speak about education. We talk in terms of A's, B's and C's instead of engagement, creative thinking and original thinking. We talk about the outcome and not the process. So the attainment of the outcome becomes the most important thing, which becomes a pressure, while the pure joy of learning falls by the wayside. I have a difficult story to tell about the pressure on kids, but it's an important part of my book. When my story, My Daughter, My Beautiful Failure, was published, a parent contacted me with this note. Hi Lucy, I'm glad your daughter made it. Sadly, my beautiful daughter, Victoria, did not make it. She fell to her death earlier this year on the first day of term two. She was only 17. I found out later through notes Victoria left behind that school was agony for her, and she was so anxious in class. She was unable to reply to teachers' questions or do presentations. She tried, my God, she tried to cope, and was able to sing in the school choir in the safety of a group. But she kept a lot of this from us, and at home was bubbly and talkative. School never told us that she was seeing a school counsellor about anxiety. We are devastated, puzzled, and left with a life where every day is a living hell without our daughter, our joy. I couldn't care if she didn't have her HSC. I just want her back. Now, I'm not religious, but when I got that note, I thought, there, but for the grace of God, go I. And maybe some of you too. I've kept in touch with Victoria's mum. She has very generously shared Victoria's diaries with me, which she allowed me to publish in my book because, and they're devastating to read, but she feels so strongly that she wants us all to be talking about this. And every day of writing my book, I thought about that girl. This is the end game for children at risk, and why we must take such great care and think so carefully about what we're doing to our kids. I know principals worry about this all the time. One I interviewed told me it was the thing that regularly keeps him awake at night. The intersection where mental health issues meet school is vexed and devilishly complex. I wrote last week in an article for The Guardian that a child's strong sense of self and their mental well-being is vastly more important and instrumental to setting them up for a successful life than a good university entrance score, and yet we imperil the former to attain the latter. So in this area of well-being, what are schools responsible for? How much are they responsible for? How much should teachers be responsible for? Should we be talking about education in terms of the whole child, about well-being, and not just programs on the side, but fully integrated? It's salutary to go back to the great philosophers on education. Plato believed the greatest goal of education was to bring out the best in people, and that knowledge acquired by compulsion, forced on the child, has no hold over the mind. Rousseau believed that individual children should learn when they are ready to learn, believed in education in nature, working with the hands, and that children should be protected from the corrupting influences of adult life. I think he'd be rolling in his grave about the adult-like pressures that we put on kids today. John Dewey said that schools should be caring communities and that education was not a preparation for life, and that mere transmission of preordained knowledge was unacceptable and ignored the interests of the individual learner. These are all potent ideas that were all echoed by every great thinker on education and pedagogy that I interviewed for my book. To a man and woman, they all put children and well-being alongside the joy and wonder of learning and urged a rethink about what success means, about broadening our ideas of success and the way we educate kids, and what school and indeed childhood is for. There are some really, really exciting things happening in education, which I think is a perfect segue for me to go and join this esteemed panel to talk about not only the problems, but the progress and how we can all be part of it. Thank you very much.